wonderful to see you here, especially if you're visiting with us. We welcome you. We hope you find it this time of worship an encounter with the living, loving God. I want to just ask everyone if you would take a minute and sign the fellowship badge in front of us along the center aisle of your pew. That helps us to know, be in touch with you after the day, and thank you for being here in worship. You'll see in your purple insert, we've got a busy day today, a busy week coming up, and I want to just highlight some of those items so that we might all be aware of them and consider how to participate in the life of our congregation. This evening at 5 o'clock, we're at the table service. Today will be in person. It'll be here in the sanctuary. It'll be a poetry and praise service. So it'll be a unique opportunity to worship some folks that have done some writing, and then Van Anthony is going to be sharing some music that goes along with that. So we hope you can join us for that time of worship this evening. Hard to believe, but next week is Vacation Bible School. And we have a great week planned for the children and members of our community who will be coming. If you haven't had a chance to register yet, please see the information in the bulletin of how to do so. And you'll also, in the email that went out this week, there was a link about donations needed for VBS crafts and supplies. So if you can help contribute toward that, I know that Blythe and Allison would be very grateful for whatever folks are able to contribute. This Saturday, June the 10th, yeah, the Fellowship Committee will be hosting our Day at the Lake, and we have a great day planned at Falls Lake, Sandling Beach. What would be most helpful to the Fellowship Committee would be if we've heard a lot of folks who are saying, yeah, I'm looking forward to going and planning, but what they would really help them is if you could RSVP using the information that's in the bulletin, because that'll help them planning for food and for activities and whatnot. So if you're planning to go, RSVP, invite a friend, invite family members. It's a great day, and I think the weather's going to be okay. The last couple of years we've done this, it's rained on us, but hopefully this year it looks right now that the weather's going to be great, so we hope you can join us for that day. I think that's all. There are other things that you can consider how you can participate in the life of our church. We're glad you are here. Let's continue our worship now. I'll invite Susan to lead us in our call to worship.
Let us stand to worship God. How majestic is our God, how worthy of our worship and praise.
When we stand in awe of our Creator, marveling at the heavens, the moon and the stars, we ask, what are we that you are mindful of us? Who are we that you care for us?
How majestic is our God, how worthy of our worship and praise.
Let us come and kneel before the Lord our God.
But our sin keeps us from rejoicing in the love God reveals. Yet Christ Jesus, the Son, carried our sins to the cross, and the Holy Spirit breathes new life into us. Let us confess our sins, that we may receive God's grace. Let us pray.
Spirit of the living God, you call us to spread the good news, to live the gospel, to teach Jesus' way to future generations. But we skirt our responsibilities and fail to act on your great mission. Forgive our silence, forgive our apathy, forgive our lack of fire. Help us be bold in faith, loving the world as Christ loves, and embodying our Savior's church. Amen.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are forgiven and freed.
May we claim our forgiveness, rejoice in God's grace, and respond with love to all.
As the Lord has forgiven us, let us also forgive one another as we share the peace of Christ with one another. May the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
I'd like to invite the children to come join me here at the front as we sit and talk for a couple minutes. Hey. How you doing?
Oh, I like those.
I need new Crocs. I love those shoes. Hey, how are you? Good to see you. Hey, Pierce. How you doing? Good. Come on up. Here comes Maggie and Jasper. So, do you guys do school, like, do you do, like field day or things out, like, yeah, on the playground and stuff? You do, like, games and things, yeah? Do you ever do like, races? Like,
yeah.
You do races? So how does, well, not until third grade. But maybe, like, sometimes, maybe, like, if you race a friend. Do you? Okay. So, like, if you ever have been in a race and you're kind of lined up and you're all there, and then how does it usually start? How does a race start? Does somebody say certain words?
What do they say?
What do they say? Ready? They say ready, set, and then what?
Go.
go, right? Go. So what do? You just stay there? You go, right? You get going. That's right. We hear that word and we're like, boom, we got to go. And then the reason I thought of that today is that there's a story, something in the Bible we're going to read. It's called the Great Commission. When Jesus, before he leaves his disciples, he tells them, he says, I want you to know that I'm going to be with you at all times, and here's what I want you to do. The very first thing he says is, go. He says, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. But the very first word he says is go. And it reminds me of kind of like a race. He wants us not necessarily stay where we are, not necessarily stay comfortable where we are. He says, I want you to leave. I want you to go into new places and meet people and to share that love with others in a way that they wouldn't otherwise have known. And kind of reminds, it kind of thinks of it the way we kind of think of a race, because we're like, okay, we're ready, we're set. And then Jesus says, go out there and do it. But you know what helps me is that sometimes when we go out and we do those new things, get a little nervous, maybe get a little scared, not sure about where we're going, if it's a new place or doing something new. The very last thing he says to his disciples is, I will be with you always. That's a great assurance to me, because sometimes in life, we kind of have to go and do things that we're not always comfortable with. But I know, and we know, that Jesus will be with us in all of those times. And even if we take that race, and maybe we don't finish first, maybe we finish last. Pastor Frank finished last in a lot of races when he had to run, I can tell you that. But it's a reminder to me that God will be with us no matter what happens. And that's important for us to always keep in mind, okay? Thank you for letting me share that with you. Let's say a prayer together before we go. Loving and gracious God, we give you thanks this day that you give us a commission and a calling to go out into this world to serve others and to share with others the love we know through your Son. Help us to not be afraid, to always feel ready and set, and to go forward, knowing that you're with us in those times. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And the congregation says,
the Lord be with you.
What do we say? Very good. I'll let you guys go back and sit with your families, okay? Have a great week. One of the things we've been doing in the month of May, the choir has been leading us at times, is singing the Psalms, singing the Psalter as a part of our worship. And today, we're all going to enjoy and experience that together, singing together Psalm 25. We're going to sing Psalm 8, but it's Hymn 25. If you'll turn to your hymn books, Hymn 25, we're going to sing the first and fifth verses, the first and last verses, and we're going to remain seated as we sing.
Ears, Holy Spirit, the Holy Word of life, tell us who we are and to whom we belong, so that we may live with gratitude for all that you have done. Amen. The scripture lesson is Matthew 28, verses 16 to 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but they doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The Great Commission. It's one of the most familiar passages in the Bible. It's Jesus's mission statement to his disciples and to his church. If we ever become lost or wayward in our focus as the body of Christ, we can return to these closing verses of Matthew's gospel and be refocused and centered on what we are called to do. Traditionally, this Sunday after Pentecost is Trinity Sunday, a day to recognize that the God we worship and adore is unique because of God's threefold nature. We know God not just in one way. We know God in three distinct, unambiguous, and meaningful ways. And yet it can be hard to get our head around what it means to believe in the one triune God. The great Augustine had to reduce it to a very simple illustration. He used the example of a tree. The root is wood, the trunk is wood, the branches are wood. One wood, one substance, but three different entities. Or another way that I've explained it to children is that you have water and ice and steam. These three things originate from the same substance, but they take three distinct final forms. In the end, however, to believe in the one triune God is to believe in a God of relationship. And perhaps in that belief, we see the connection with Jesus' Great Commission. For just as God relates to God's children in three distinct ways, so too does the church relate to its world as Christ's body in a multitude of ways, all of which seek to transform the world through God's boundless love. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore. Last weekend, we celebrated Memorial Day in our country. One of the most solemn places that I have visited is the Normandy American Cemetery in France. And each Memorial Day, I recall being on that hallowed ground. Looking out over the English Channel from those cliffs, I recalled the unbelievable amount of logistical planning and on-the-fly decisions which had to be made for that D-Day invasion. Whether it was on that day or for any military exercise, the chain of command is essential for success. An order is given to push forward, to stand down, to engage the enemy. And the order is followed because it bears the weight of the chain of command that's above it. There is authority behind the order, and soldiers obey that order because they know on whose authority it is from. Jesus gives this commission to his disciples based on the authority granted to him by God. Jesus didn't make it up himself. He says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. It was given to him by God, and through that authority, Jesus commands his disciples. And we receive that command with the knowledge of the chain of command that it originates from. And that command begins, as I talked with the children, with the word go. It's active and it's forceful. Jesus didn't say stay or remain. He says go. And inferred in that command is that we cannot fulfill his commission by standing still or remaining where we are. As his disciples, we must go from where we are comfortable and meet God's children in the world. Jesus did not say, remain here and you will fulfill my commandment. He said, go therefore to serve in my name. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. I may have shared this before, but if I ever had the courage to suggest a constitutional amendment to the Book of Order of the Presbyterian Church USA, it would relate to Section G1.04, which is titled Categories of Membership. Throughout the Book of Order, we speak of membership in the church. Funny thing, though, Jesus didn't say, go therefore and make members of all nations. He said, go and make disciples of all nations. When we say we are members of the church, it implies that we've paid our dues and we are part of an exclusive club with certain benefits. To be a disciple, though, means to be a follower of someone and to live your life according to your leader's beliefs. Jesus commands us to make disciples of all nations. He wants peoples of all nations to be his followers, not members of an exclusive club of which he is the president. He yearns for a church that follows his lead with acts of love and grace, with words of compassion and challenge, with examples of grace and faithfulness. Our Lord commands us to make disciples who follow him not just one day of the week, but each and every day of their lives. But how do we do that as individuals and as the body of Christ? Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The first way we make disciples of all nations is by baptizing others in the name of the one triune God. It matters not whether someone is sprinkled, dunked, or something in between. It matters not whether the person's a baby, a child, a teenager, or an adult. What matters is that someone wishes to become a follower and disciple of Jesus, and they confirm that decision by being baptized as Jesus was baptized. Next Sunday, we will have the honor and the privilege of baptizing Isabel Vaughn, daughter of Alessandra and Casey Vaughn, as part of our morning worship service. And whenever we baptize a child, we as the congregation promise to guide and nurture this child by word and deed, with love and prayer, encouraging them to know and follow Christ. We make disciples of all nations when we take that vow seriously, and not only follow Christ in our daily walk of faith, but mentor and nurture those baptized in the name of the one triune God. And teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. Our family growing up was not a sports family as far as our girls were concerned. We were a music family. We were band, orchestra, anything music. And part of that was Debbie's upbringing. Her dad was a middle school orchestra director for most of his career. And I've often said that the most patient woman I've ever met in the world was my mother-in-law, because she had to sit through countless middle school orchestra concerts through her lifetime. When our girls were in band during that time in their life, it was striking to me to note the difference from their first concert in sixth grade to their last concert in eighth grade. That first concert, whew, that was tough to sit through, to be sure. But that last concert was so good, it was hard to believe it was the same musicians. And as is often the case with such improvement, the primary credit must go to their teacher. It took creativity to grab each of those students' attention. It took patience to work through their ups and downs with each of those students. It took passion to inspire each of those students. And it took foresight to see how those individual students could grow into a cohesive, dynamic whole. I am always deeply grateful for all those who are called to be teachers, who inspire, who are patient, and who see the good in every child whom they teach. That is what the Christian life demands, that we teach others with creativity and passion and patience and foresight. I read one commentator who compared it to being in a lifelong internship. We make disciples of all nations when we teach others about grace and justice and humility and service. And we teach not just in the expected settings of worship and sermons and in the classroom. We also teach discipleship in the less expected ways, by inviting someone to try something new, by listening to a teenager who's struggling with life, by working alongside someone despite your differences of opinion, by showing kindness and respect to someone that everyone else would dismiss. The Christian life, it's never perfected or aced like an exam in a class. It is a lifelong internship of mutual learning, where the Spirit opens the mind and the heart to forever be challenged and deepened in the knowledge of the one triune God. And the great assurance Jesus leaves his disciples and all of us are those last words of the Great Commission. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. When we struggle to go as our Lord has commanded us, remember, I am with you always. When we aren't sure about how best to make disciples in Christ's name, remember, I am with you always. When we yearn for more to be baptized and welcomed into the church, remember, I am with you always. When we don't know how to best teach discipleship, remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Our faith is in the one triune God who gives us everything we need to fulfill the Great Commission. The strength of God the Father, the love of God the Son, and the abiding presence of God the Spirit. That is our God now and always. So go, make, baptize, and teach. And remember, God is with you always to the end of the age. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you. At this time, we have the joy of recognizing, giving thanks for those in our congregation and connected to our congregation who are graduates. I think today we have Wes, come on up. We are grateful to be able to recognize Wes Goodman today. Wes is the son of April and John Goodman and is also the grandson of Phil Westerman. Congratulations. We are glad you are here. Wes is going to be graduating from Athens Drive High School this week. When's graduation?
June 10th.
So next week, or on Saturday. Mm-hmm. We also are grateful today. We also want to recognize and give thanks. They couldn't be here today with us today, but we also are grateful for Alexa Grady, who is the daughter of Bruce and Michelle Grady. She graduated from the North Carolina School of the Arts and will be attending UNC Charlotte. We also recognize and are grateful for Omar Hamad, who graduated from Duke Divinity School with a Master's of Divinity degree. But we are excited for what's ahead for you. We want you to know you're in our prayers always as you go forward in peace. We have a small gift to give you, some words of poetry and inspiration, and know that in our congregation you are loved greatly, and we're excited for what's ahead. Can we give thanks to Wes and congratulate him? Let me offer a word of prayer for all of our graduates. Let us pray. Eternal God, your wisdom is greater than our small minds can attain, and your truth shows up our little learning. To those who study, give curiosity, imagination, and patience enough to wait and work for insight. Help them to doubt with courage, but to hold all their doubts in the larger faith of Jesus Christ our Lord. Eternal God, in your will our lives are lived, and by your wisdom truth is found. We pray for Wes, Alexa, and Omar, who have finished their courses of study and are moving on to something new. Take away anxiety or confusion of purpose, and give them confidence in the future that you plan, where energies may be gathered up and given to neighbors in love, as they conclude one chapter and begin a new chapter in their lives. May they know that they are never alone in this journey that lies ahead of them, for they have been, are, and always will be held closely, not only in our thoughts and prayers, but most especially in the palm of your loving hands. We ask all of this for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Congratulations. We are excited for you. And as we depart today after the service, hope you'll join us. The CE committee is going to have some light refreshments and cookies just outside the main entrance, out under the portico. So we hope you all can come and join and congratulate Wes on his accomplishments and what's ahead for him. So thanks. Thank you. Congratulations. Thanks. I invite us now. We come to a time when we give back to God all that we have. Let us offer to God our lives and the gifts which we bring today.
Thank you.
Most generous God, you have blessed us with gifts to serve and to share. May the offerings we present today be used to further your kingdom and to build your beloved community. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Grab that first. Thanks. Before we come and celebrate this feast which our Lord has prepared for us, let me just mention a couple of things. One, we will be serving you where you are. We'll be bringing the bread first in individual cups. And then following that, the juice. Well, our practice in our congregation is that we wait until everyone's received the bread first. We partake of that together once everyone's received it, and we do the same with the juice. And know that for those who have dietary needs, all the bread today is gluten-free. So we hope that that'll be an open invitation for those who have those needs. We also lift up today in our prayers those who are on our hearts and minds. Let me share with you some that I'm aware of, and if anyone has some joys or concerns, raise your hand and we'll be sure to include those as well. We remember today Mason Moore, who is Denise Weeks and Henry Burke's grandson. He returned back to Memphis this week to St. Jude's Children's Hospital for his continued cancer treatments. So our prayers are with Mason and his family. And we also remember Henry Burke's mother, Marjorie Honeycutt, who had a fall on Thursday evening or Friday morning and went to UNC Rex to be checked out. Turns out she didn't have any breaks or any whatnot, but they did determine that she has pneumonia. And so Marjorie's been admitted and is at UNC Rex for that and continues to be cared there. And in our community this week, our neighbors and friends at Combs Elementary suffered a great tragedy. So we remember the family of one of their students, and I apologize if I'm not saying the name right, Ian Vacherie, who's a fourth grade student at Combs Elementary, who was killed on Memorial Day. He lived in Apex and was riding his scooter in his neighborhood, and a car hit him and died. And so our prayers are with that family, with the Combs community, and as they experience this unspeakable tragedy. Are there others that you would mention, either joys or concerns that we might be aware of? Yeah, Blythe.
I have two. First, a joy. I just want to say thank you to everybody who came out yesterday to the car wash. That was our youth fundraiser for our spring and summer conferences and mission trips. We raised, I think, we don't have the online total yet, but we think we're at $1,500.
That's great.
Which is phenomenal.
Yeah.
So thank you to everyone from the church community, but also one of the more remarkable things yesterday is we had a bunch of people from the neighborhood come and support our youth, which is just one of the things that I love the most about this community. And then a concern that I want to share is just everybody remember that our elementary and middle and high school students have testing this week. They're all taking EOGs and final exams and final projects for AP classes. So if we can just keep our students and the teachers who have to grade all that mess in our prayers, I would appreciate it.
Thank you, Blythe. Thank you. Anyone else?
I actually have a request for prayers. Lydia has 37 teammates that are traveling to Sarasota, Florida, and we just pray that everybody gets there safe and sound. We've got people on planes, people in cars, and I just want them all there in one piece.
Amen.
Don't pray for winning, just pray for getting them safe.
Right.
So.
Sounds good. Any others?
Ron and I are heading to a funeral service, well, more like a celebration of life. Later today, a good friend of ours, Randy, passed away from cancer, and he's been struggling for a while, but he's at peace now. So please say a prayer for Randy's family. Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer. And that reminds me as well, we have a number of folks who traveled to Wilmington today to surround the Kinnett family as they celebrate the life of Liza Kinnett this afternoon at 2:00. So our prayers are with them as well as they gather for that day. We'll hold all of these up to God in prayer. My friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. People will come from north and south, from east and west, and will sit at table in God's heavenly kingdom. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to them. And that's when their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. This table is the Lord's table. Our Savior invites all who trust and believe in him to share in this feast, which he has prepared. May the Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, eternal and triune God. You spoke the world into being. Your word became flesh in Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, you made us your people. When we were lost in sin, you found us, sending us your prophets and even your own Son. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Born of Mary, he came to dwell among us, full of grace and truth. He forgave our failures, healed our hurts, and gave himself in utter sacrifice for those he loved. After 3 days, you raised him from the dead, that we might never die. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of our Lord. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share in this feast. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer our Savior taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On the night of his arrest, our Lord Jesus was at table with his disciples. And he took a loaf of bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them. He said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took a cup. He said, This cup is the new covenant, which is sealed in my blood. It is shed for you, for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. thanks. Given for us. Blood of Christ shed for us all. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, you have filled us with your life. Christ, our Savior, you have embraced us in your love. God, our parent, you have fed us with your grace. Now send us out into your beloved world to share your life, your love, your grace with all. Blessing and honor and glory to you, holy, holy, holy Lord. Amen. Serve the Lord. May the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you, now and forevermore. Amen.